Good morning, church. Let's pray as we prepare to encounter God in His Word again this morning. Father, we thank You for word and song and in Your Word read to us. And Father, I pray that You would prepare our hearts even now as we get ready to walk through this passage together, that maybe some of us came in with hardened hearts, calluses on our hearts, our ears stopped up, or our minds distracted by a dozen different things. And Father, I pray that You would just clear our hearts and minds. You would open our ears. You would open our eyes to behold wondrous things from Your Word today, to behold You in truth, in glory, in all of Your majesty and might and mercy. Father, that just as the goal we've heard again and again of what You're doing in these acts is so that the whole world will know that You alone are Yahweh. You alone are the God who is enthroned and who saves His people and who delights in dwelling among us, showing us mercy. Father, that You would show us who You are again today, that Christ would be lifted up, that we would be drawn to Him in faith and worship. And we ask this all in His name. Amen. We've got a lot of ground to cover in the Word this morning, and we're walking through this final cycle of plagues. This is the most extensive cycle of plagues. And so let's quickly, literary structure of these 10 acts of judgment that God brings upon Pharaoh in Egypt, they follow a really clear pattern. There are three sets of three judgments, which then set up the final 10th act of judgment with the death of the firstborn in Egypt. Throughout these 10 acts, just by way of reminder, God hand over the entire world. He is demonstrating through each of these plagues His authority over Egypt's ruler, over Egypt's gods, and His authority over all creation. By the end of the story, what we're left with, or what Egypt is left with, rather, is a dethroned king, defeated deities, and a decreated land. But these acts of judgment are also, we see, God's acts of salvation for His people. Throughout Scripture, that truth that God is judge is inseparably linked from that truth that God is Savior, right? They're not at odds. They go together. So His acts of decreation and deliverance are all done to leave no doubt in the minds of Egyptians, no doubt in the minds of the Israelites, and no doubt in the minds of us, the readers and listeners, that there is no one like Yahweh. He's the holy Creator and sovereign King. So let's pay attention to how God reveals that truth in this final cycle of plagues. Like the last couple of weeks, what we'll do is go on something like a walking tour of the passage, pointing out a few things along the way, and then we will sum up some truths about God at the end, the God that we must respond to. So where we ended in Exodus 9:12 last Sunday, the situation for Egypt is grim, to say the least. Pharaoh's magicians, who previously were trying to go round for round with Moses and go miracle for miracle with him, they are covered in nasty, pus-filled sores, so much so that they can't even show up for this showdown with Moses and the Lord. So Pharaoh, despite all the clear evidence of Yahweh's supremacy and rule over him, he refuses to give in. He continues to harden his heart. God continues to harden Pharaoh's heart. And that leads us to the final cycle, which begins with plague number 7, this hailstorm. And since Andrew just read it to us a few moments ago, let's focus in on some highlights. First, we see that the cycle begins in the same way the previous two cycles did, with an early morning confrontation, and it includes the same message from Yahweh to Pharaoh: "Let my people go, that they may serve me." But there's also a clear escalation at this point in the story in verse 14. It says, "For this time I will send all my plagues on you yourself." You might have a footnote saying it could be translated a bit more literally in the Hebrew. "For this time I will send all my plagues on your heart." And we know that that heart language has been really important to this point in the text. He will send all my plagues He will send all his plagues on Pharaoh's heart and on your servants and your people, so that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. So up to this point, the plagues have been pretty awful. I don't think that we would want to experience any of them, but they've been really massive interruptions in the Egyptians' lives. But with what's about to come, the Lord is essentially telling him that the gloves are coming off, right? The full assault is now coming. It's been building up to this. So second and related to that, God expands here on his reason for these signs, his purposes for them. In verse 15, he tells Pharaoh straight up, "For by now I could have put out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, and you would have been cut off from the earth." In other words, it's not like God has bad aim, or he's sending the plagues because he hasn't figured out how to kill them off instantly yet. Right? It's not like he's experimenting with them. He could do it with a word if he chose to. And other biblical stories show us God is not bluffing here. 2 Kings 18 through 19, a similar showdown happens between Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, and Yahweh. The Assyrian king is mocking the Israelites for putting their faith in Yahweh when no other god has been able to stand up to the Assyrians. He thinks it's laughable that anybody would try to resist them. Hezekiah then prays to Yahweh that he would act in such a way that all would know he alone is Yahweh, God. Sound familiar? What's God's response to the prayer? Well, it's a long one, and it would be worth reading in full if we had enough time there, but let me just read you the ending of it in 2 Kings 19, 32 through 35. "Therefore, thus says Yahweh concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into the city, or shoot an arrow there, or come before it with a shield, or cast up a siege mound against it. By the way that he came, by the same he shall return, and he shall not come into the city, declares Yahweh. For I will defend this city to save it, for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David." And that night, the angel of Yahweh went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. And when people arose early in the morning, behold, these were all dead bodies. Can you imagine that scene? And we're about to witness something similar happen in the 10th plague in Egypt. And so God is more than capable of taking life instantly. But in verse 16, he tells Pharaoh that he's been raised up for this purpose. The reason for the 10 plagues, for the unfolding of the plagues, is for this purpose: to display God's power over him in order that Yahweh's name would be proclaimed in all the earth. The name of Yahweh would be made known. Pharaoh is still pridefully exalting himself, but God's telling him, "I'm going to exalt my own name through your humiliation." The next feature to pay attention to here is the warning that God issues and the response of the Egyptians, or the responses of the Egyptians, we could say. We're told this hailstorm will be worse than any Egypt had endured. It will leave no doubt. I feel like if I want to cause a fight in the winter, I just try to tell someone that I know what the most severe winter storm you guys have ever endured in New England is. It's a matter of debate. It's right. No, it was this year. No, it was this year. We do the same with hurricane ratings or tornadoes that people have experienced. But what God is saying is, like, there's not going to be a debate when this is over with. You're not going to go, "Well, actually, I remember a hailstorm that was worse than this." It's like, you won't. There's nothing that people will have experienced like this before. And so the people are warned that it's going to be so severe that any human or animal left outside will be struck down and killed. So the people received this word, and they respond in two very different ways. Whoever feared the word of Yahweh acted immediately and hurried their people and cattle into their houses. And whoever didn't fear Yahweh's word did nothing. Some Egyptians' eyes, we see, are beginning to open, right? They're getting the picture, and they're responding immediately. And others are still living in denial. And then in verses 22 through 26, the storm comes. It does exactly what God said it would. It rains hail, thunder, lightning, striking down every animal, plant, and human exposed to it. And this is where we see that theme of decreation pop up again. In Genesis, remember, what are the blessings that come from the land? The blessings that arise from the earth. You have plants, have animals, have mankind. And through this hail from the sky, God is reversing the land blessing in Egypt. Plants, animals, humans are killed if they're exposed to it. Only in Goshen, we're told, where the people are, this garden-like haven for them, are they safe. And then notice Pharaoh's response to all this in verse 27. Then Pharaoh sent and called Moses and Aaron and said to them, "This time I have sinned. Yahweh is in the right, and I, my people, are in the wrong. Plead with the Lord, for there has been enough of God's thunder and hail. I will let you go, and you shall stay no longer." If we just stopped right there and had to make a judgment call, we might say that Pharaoh's heart has finally changed, that this is true repentance. He checks all the boxes, right? He confesses that he sinned. He acknowledges that Yahweh is in the right, and he and his people are in the wrong. He asks Moses to plead with God, and he promises to obey his word immediately. Like, just baptize him, take him into the membership of the people, right? Pharaoh seems changed, but Moses and the Lord see through it. Verses 29 through 30. Moses said to him, "As soon as I've gone out of the city, I'll stretch out my hands to Yahweh. The thunder will cease. There'll be no more hail, so that you may know that the earth is Yahweh's. But as for you and your servants, I know that you do not yet fear Yahweh God." And Moses is right. In verses 34 through 35, the storm stops. Pharaoh sins again. He hardens his heart. He refuses to let the people go. And we ought to pause here because we are given very clearly a portrait of what false repentance looks like. It's a warning for us to heed. Even though Pharaoh has all the external appearances of brokenness, he still hasn't changed his heart. What he values most, what he treasures, has not changed. The reason for his confession is because he fears losing what he values most, his kingdom, his position. It is not because he fears Yahweh. And as soon as the threat and the pressure stops, he changes course. Changes his mind. Goes back on his promise. He illustrates the type of response that many people have to God, though, that falls short of genuine repentance and faith. Like Pharaoh, many people turn to God for relief from suffering or relief from the consequences of sin, but they don't actually want release from their sin. They don't want to be freed from their worship of self in order to serve God alone. Some examples would be in moments of crisis when we turn to God for help, maybe asking the question, for what reason? Like, what's the purpose that we're turning to God for? When we say things or pray things like, we want the disease or the cancer to go away, the surgery to go well, the job interview to work out, the bank account to increase, this relationship that we're invested in to blossom, to get a high score on this exam. But the question is, why? Is it because we want to use our lives, our health, our money, our jobs, our educations, our relationships to serve and magnify God? Or do we want those things because ultimately we want them to serve our own name? What we value most, which is ourselves. True repentance and confession is rooted in this, a supreme love for God, and a desire to magnify his name no matter what. Pharaoh lacks that. His heart is hardened, which leads to the eighth plague, locusts, in Exodus 10, 1 through 20. So we pick up in the first verse there. "Then Yahweh said to Moses, 'Go into Pharaoh, for I've hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I may show these signs of mine among them, and that you may tell in the hearing of your son and of your grandson how I've dealt harshly with the Egyptians, and what signs I've done among them, that you may know that I am Yahweh.'" There's the message again. So the purpose of the plagues is expanded one more time. Not only is God's humiliation of Egypt, his judgment of them, done so that they'll know that he is the Lord, it's done so that future generations of God's people will know who he is. As that message is passed on generation after generation, They are to know God according to these acts of judgment and deliverance. That these stories, just like they do for us now as God's people, are meant in times of suffering and oppression, they're meant to bring comfort to us. They remind us that our God is supreme and he is faithful to his people always. But they also serve as warnings against Pharaoh-like pride and hard-heartedness and rebellion. And so in verses 3 through 6, Moses and Aaron go to Pharaoh once more, and they tell him, "Thus says Yahweh, the God of the Hebrews, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? Let my people go that they may serve me. For if you refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow I will bring locusts into your country, and they shall cover the face of the land so that no one can see the land, and they shall eat what is left to you after the hail, and they shall eat every tree of yours that grows in the field, and they shall fill your houses and the houses of all your servants and of all the Egyptians, as neither your fathers nor your grandfathers have seen from the day that they came on earth to this day." Then he turned and went out from Pharaoh. And so we were told in the last story, in plague number 7, that some of the plants weren't destroyed. And so you're almost given a little bit of hope that maybe there will be some food after all. And that hope is short-lived. It's kind of like, I'm thinking of a few cartoon scenes, right, where it seems like there's like that little glimmer of hope left after something happens, and then whatever's remaining just catches on fire right in the moment. It's like, and there it goes, right? There was the last bit of hope that we had. Right, and that's what he's telling them, right? You think that you've got this? No, locusts are coming to eat what's left. And starting in verse 7, another new development emerges. For the first time, Pharaoh's servants put some serious pressure on him. It says, "Then his servant said to him, 'How long shall this man be a snare to us? Let the men go, that they may serve Yahweh their God. Do you not yet understand that Egypt is ruined?'" It's like this guy is leading with blinders on. So Moses and Aaron were brought back to Pharaoh. And so you can see Pharaoh, you can imagine him acting really tough after the warning is issued, right? But these servants who have, no doubt they've dealt more directly with the consequences of these plagues, having to deal with the people, Pharaoh would be more protected from some of this. They've had enough. So I'm imagining it being like a conference call, right? They're all listening into this conversation. Moses says that the locusts are going to eat all their food and cover the land, and Pharaoh crosses his arms and says, "Fine, bring it on." And his servants are like, "No, pick the phone back up. Like, get these guys back in here. This is enough. Like, stop letting them do this. Do you not realize what's happening?" And so Pharaoh does. He brings them back, verse 8, and he said to them, "Go serve Yahweh your God." That should be the end of it. But he always has to have a condition, right? He needs to be in control. He's still the negotiator. So he says, "But which ones are to go?" Moses said, "We will go with our young and our old. We will go with our sons and daughters and with our flocks and herds, for we must hold a feast to Yahweh." It's like a very sophisticated way of saying everybody and everything. Like, we're all leaving. But he said to them, "Yahweh be with you. The Lord be with you if ever I let you and your little ones go. Look, you have some evil purpose in mind. No, go the men among you and serve Yahweh, for that is what you're asking." It's like, that's not what I'm asking. And they were driven out from Pharaoh's presence. Just notice a bit of Pharaoh's worldview here. It seems that for Pharaoh and the Egyptians, worshiping one's God was a grown man's activity. Why do you need women and children with you to worship? Go hold the feast with the men. But for God's people, every worshiper matters, right? There are no qualifications. He is to be worshipped and served by men, women, children, young, old. As Christ's people, we don't have any of those requirements needed to come to Christ. There is one requirement, all that matters. Do you worship, serve, and trust in the Lord alone? And so he tells them, we're all going. It's not just a men's retreat for the Israelites. Corporate worship service. Well, Pharaoh's response clearly falls short. So the Lord tells Moses to stretch out his hand and bring the locusts. And here's where that decreation theme pops up again. Notice how the locusts arrive. In verse 13, it says, Moses stretched out his staff over the land of Egypt, and Yahweh brought an east wind upon the land all that day and all that night. When it was morning, the east wind brought the locusts. And then if you drop down to verse 19, We're told at the end of this that the Lord turned this wind into a strong west wind that takes the locust away to the Red Sea after Moses prays for Pharaoh. The key to notice here is the Hebrew word ruach, which is translated wind. In Genesis 1, the first place that we encounter that word is when the ruach is the Spirit of God hovering over the face of the waters at creation. And in the creation story, that ruach, the ruach, is present to bring about all these blessings of creation. But now, another ruach brings locusts that takes all those blessings away from Egypt. In verse 16, Pharaoh again looks like he confesses his sin and repents. He even asks for forgiveness and to have his death removed from him. But as soon as the locusts are carried off, Yahweh hardens his heart. He doesn't let the people go. He remains committed to his previous position. One more thing to note that sets up then the ninth plague. Look in verses 14 through 15 of chapter 10. We're told that the locusts came up over all the land of Egypt and settled on the whole country of Egypt, such a dense swarm of locusts as had never been before, nor ever will be again. So there's that language again of the uniqueness of the event. They covered the face of the whole land so that the land was darkened. Locusts are so dense that the ground is covered to the point of there being darkness over the surface of Egypt. And that leads to the final plague of the third cycle, where a much thicker darkness arrives. Verse 21. Then Yahweh said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over land of Egypt, a darkness to be felt." So you pause there for a second. Some people will protest at this point, like, aha, you can't feel darkness. And so this must mean that either, you know, that it's something else is going on here. Maybe like a sandstorm of sorts that's covering them, and so they can feel the darkness. But I think it's an easier solution to that, because it's a tough phrase to capture in translation. The best rendering, I think, would be something like a darkness that causes feeling, meaning a darkness that causes you to feel around in the dark, right? That's what's going on here, is they're not going to be able to see in front of them. They're going to have to be groping in the dark to find their way around. And so we continue to verse 22. Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and there was pitch darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from his place for 3 days, but all the people of Israel had light where they lived. Then Pharaoh called Moses and said, "Go serve Yahweh. Your little ones also may go with you. Only let your flocks and your herds remain behind." So, you've got this darkness that sets in. I don't think that we can really fathom like how interruptive this would have been in their life to just be stuck at home when there's already a shortage of many resources that have been doled out through the previous plagues, and to just be stuck. They can't move, can't see. Talking about sense deprivation, just people going crazy, right, during all of this. And this guy, Pharaoh, has not seen a ray of light in 3 days, and he still feels like he's in a position to negotiate. That tells him to leave the flocks and the herds behind. But Moses said, verse 25, "You must also let us have sacrifices and burnt offerings, that we may sacrifice to Yahweh our God. Our livestock must also go with us, not a hoof shall be left behind, for we must take them to serve Yahweh our God, and we do not know with what we must serve Yahweh until we arrive there." Verse 27, "But Yahweh hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let them go. Then Pharaoh said to him, 'Get away from me. Take care never to see my face again, for on the day you see my face, you shall die.' Moses said, 'As you say, I will not see your face again.'" Some ominous words. Just note a few things here. First, the theme of decreation and the cycle of plagues comes to an obvious conclusion here. Just as God said on day one of creation, "Let there be light," so in verse 21, he literally says, "Let there be darkness." Egypt is reduced to the state of creation before God spoke light into it. It is a total judgment upon them. And next, notice again the tragedy of Pharaoh's response. Not only is he still trying to work a deal, but when he fails, he threatens to kill God's servant. Like every visit from Moses to him is an act of mercy from God. That he even has someone that he can speak with and then appeal to go plead with God. Like this is the mediator, the access that he has. And now he turns against him and threatens to take his life from him. As Douglas Stewart notes in his commentary, he says, Pharaoh was trying to get rid of the problem of Yahweh's demands by preventing Yahweh's chosen messenger from bringing those demands to his attention. And in doing so, Pharaoh illustrates a theme that's played out time and time again in human history that we could see around us today. That is when God's word comes to people, calling them to repent, calling them to acknowledge him as the only God and Savior, two responses ultimately happen. Either people listen to his voice and obey it, or they seek in some way to silence it. Either by avoiding it, or stopping it, shutting down whoever's speaking it. Jesus' crucifixion is the chief illustration of this reality. When Jesus arrives and begins proclaiming the arrival of God's kingdom and the need to repent and believe in the gospel, some people, by God's grace, listen and believe. For others, Jesus begins as something of an inconvenience, an interruption into their lives, to eventually someone whose very presence is intolerable. And so I think it's worth us asking the question, what our response is to God's word when it comes to us? Are our ears open and our hearts receptive to listen and obey whatever it is that God speaks to us? Or in our own ways, do we try to negotiate, change the terms a bit, or even block it out so that it's our voice that we listen to? So the curtain closes on this final cycle of plagues. Next week, we'll begin walking through that final climactic plague, the death of the firstborn, the Passover, the deliverance of God's people. I want to spend our remaining few minutes focusing on three things, though, that we've seen of God in these first nine acts of judgment. The first thing to summarize is God's mission. God has made his ultimate purpose in the Exodus crystal clear to this point. He is on a mission to be known by his people and by all nations as the one true God, Yahweh. You cannot miss it. We've heard it on repeat. We witness it again today in Exodus 9, 14 through 16. Why has God raised up Pharaoh? So that through his demise, Yahweh's name would be made much of in all the earth. Think about that language, making much of his name in all the earth. Because that's why every one of us exists, friends. We exist to make much of God, to glorify him, to make disciples of him here and throughout the world. This is the mission we see the Father send the Son to accomplish. What does Jesus Christ do? He comes and he makes the Father known. He lays down his life so that through faith in him, we can be reconciled to the Father and know him and worship him. And this is the mission that Jesus has sent us to carry out among the nations. Go, make disciples of all nations. We are spreading his glory far and wide. 1 Peter 2:9, we are to go and proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And so when we bring that home here at CBC, understand that our mission as a church flows directly out of this mission of God himself. Why do we exist? It's waiting for someone just to heartily shout the mission statement. But it's okay, I'll say it for you. I know that in your heart you're doing the same. It is to glorify God by knowing him, treasuring him, offering him to the world. And this is key. What it means to live on mission. What we're ultimately talking about is that we are committed, we are most committed to what God is most committed to. God is committed to the glory and magnification of his own name. Because he is infinitely and incomparably valuable, it's a good thing for him to be committed to that because there's nothing better than that. And our top priority, therefore, is to know him, love him, treasure him, and make him known to others. So how do we participate in that mission together? For sure, it means that we promote the gospel of Christ among the nations. We promote his name among all peoples. We want not only to be a church that supports missions work, but also that continually raises up and sends out laborers to make Jesus known where he's not known. We also see, though, in this passage that this mission begins right where we are, with our children, with the next generation among us at CBC, with our neighbors, with people we rub shoulders with every day. If Jesus is supremely valuable to us, we will make him known to others. And so a second theme to reflect on here is God's mercy. See once again the extent of God's patience and restraint with Egypt, but also I want us to focus in today on his purposes for Egypt long term. Looking at God's patience, as a dad, this is always convicting because of the number of times, I even think we talked about this on our parent-child sermon in Ephesians, we talk about it with our kids, and this is still important to any kids that I have in the room, that obedience should happen the first time we tell them to do something. Right? We say that a lot. It shouldn't take saying this 2, 3, 4, 5, you get it, many times. The first time that we ask you to do something, that's when it needs to be done. But then you reflect on your own response to the Lord, and there's the conviction right there of how many times we have to be told the same thing over and over again. And then you see God's patience with even someone like Pharaoh. This dude's like a cat with 9 lives. Yahweh doesn't owe him a single second chance, and he has every right to take his life and his kingdom from him instantly. And yet he is given opportunity after opportunity to humble himself, to repent, to obey God's word, and he receives mercy in this. But as we've noted in previous weeks, it's not Pharaoh and Egypt alone who receive mercy. It's a mercy that judgment doesn't fall on Israel as well. Their protection in the land of Goshen is not a reward for their goodness. It is a gift of God's grace. We can often miss this part of the narrative, but Egypt was not the only nation that was worshiping idols. In Joshua 24:14, we're told this, when Joshua says, "Now therefore fear Yahweh and serve him in sincerity and faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve Yahweh." We're meant to like read that and go, hold up a minute. Joshua's telling us that many of the Israelites had become worshipers of these false Egyptian gods. And yet for both Egypt and Israel and all who would hear this story, God showcases his mercy in not only crushing false gods, but in claiming and rescuing those who were once enslaved to those gods. We see that in glimpses in the Exodus story where some Egyptians fear the word of Yahweh, and in Exodus 12:38, some even leave Egypt with Israel. When we get to the prophets, though, we see that God has a much larger purpose for the nations, and that includes Egypt. So listen, just for example, to Isaiah 19:19-25. We're told, "In that day there will be an altar to Yahweh in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar to Yahweh at its border. It will be a sign and a witness to Yahweh of hosts in the land of Egypt. When they cry to Yahweh because of oppressors, he will send them a savior and defender and deliver them. And Yahweh will make himself known to the Egyptians. And the Egyptians will know Yahweh in that day." And get this, "they will worship with sacrifice and offering, and they will make vows to Yahweh and perform them. And Yahweh will strike Egypt, striking and healing. And they will return to Yahweh, and he will listen to their pleas for mercy and heal them. In that day, there will be a highway from Egypt to Assyria," right? These ancient enemies of the people of God. "And Assyria will come into Egypt, and Egypt into Assyria, and the Egyptians will worship with the Assyrians. In that day, Israel will be the third with Egypt and Assyria, a blessing in the midst of the earth, whom Yahweh of hosts has blessed, saying, 'Blessed be Egypt, my people, and Assyria, the work of my hands, and Israel, my inheritance.'" We see just a glimpse of it here, but we see that God is on a mission to showcase his glory by showing his mercy among the nations. And we know the story ends with a people, in the last book, rescued from every tribe, tongue, and nation, and that includes Egypt, worshiping the Lord Jesus around his throne. And so that leads to the final call then, when we see God's mission, his majesty, his mercy, that because of God's great glory, we also must respond to his mandate, that we would humbly and urgently repent and believe in the Lord Jesus. This is Paul's message in Acts 17 to the Athenians. It says, "The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." So Pharaoh's our example of what not to do when confronted with the word of the Lord and the truth of who God is. Don't exalt yourself. Don't cover your ears. Don't harden your heart. God's patience and kindness are meant to lead us to repentance and life. And so the dethronement of Pharaoh, the decreation of Egypt, are all screaming to us this truth, that if we put our hopes in this world, brothers and sisters, we will lose everything. We will lose everything in the end. It's like boarding a plane or ship knowing that its destination is going to be a crash. It's going down. But for those who trust in God, he will save his people and he will dwell with them forever. We see that story unfolding in the Exodus. He's bringing them into a land where he'll be with them. But that theme of decreation and new creation are certainly not restricted to the Exodus story. This is pointing us forward, a picture of things to come. And so the things that we see, like in the story of Noah, where decreation happens, which leads to a restored creation, and what we see here happening in the Exodus, one day that's going to come to a climactic ending in the day of the Lord, where God is once and for all going to judge sin and save his people and bring them into a new heavens and a new earth. And we read of that in 2 Peter 3, 10 through 13. So I want us to heed this warning and exhortation as we close out our time. Peter writes, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and all the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn? But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells." If you're exalting yourself, living for this world, it's not a good ending. But if our response is this, looking to Jesus, following him, looking in faith to him and imitating him in holiness and godliness, waiting for his return, longing for this creation of a new land where righteousness dwells, that's our hope, church. So let's pray as we respond to his word. Father, we thank you. Thank you that we have the hope of a new creation. That already, if we are in Christ, we're told we are new creations. That you've raised us from death to life. Your spirit dwells in us. And Father, we praise you for your grace and mercy to us in that way. And ask now that as we come before you to respond to your word, you would help fix our eyes on those things. As we read earlier in Colossians 3, that we would look to the things that are above, not the things here on earth. We would look to Christ, who is our hope, who is our life. And so, Father, for any here that have not responded in repentance and faith, who have not responded to this call to turn away from sin and self to Christ, Father, we plead that you would lead them to that response today. That you would melt hard hearts. You would open blind eyes. you would draw them to yourself to see your beauty and grace and mercy that is given to us in Christ. And Father, for we who know Christ, to pray that you would make us more passionate today about this mission that you've called us to participate in. That we would, it would be our greatest joy and highest treasure to know you and to make you known to others. And so, Father, as we reflect on your word, as we respond to it, pray that you'd be at work by your Spirit in us to fix our eyes on Christ, to make us more like him. And we ask this all in his name. Amen.